So in this particular tutorial, we'll be discussing about two problems pertaining with the frequency response characteristics of bipolar junction transistor amplifier. And more specifically, we'll be dealing with the amplifiers operating in the common emitter configuration. And perhaps you know that for a common emitter amplifier, we can have different types of transistors, I mean, different types of capacitors, which are there, and these capacitors are playing a pivotal role in controlling the bandwidth of any amplifier. In fact, we can subdivide those capacitors into two different categories. One is known as the external capacitor, like the coupling capacitor, the bypass capacitor, and the load capacitor, which you can connect externally to the circuit. And second one is the transistor internal capacitor. So internal side, we have the base emitter capacitor and the base collector. So intentionally today, I'll be taking up two different problems. In the first problem, I'll be taking up the effect of the coupling capacitor in controlling the bandwidth or in controlling the lower cutoff frequency of any amplifier circuit. And in the second problem, the effect of the internal capacitors will be taken into account. So let me start with a simple common emitter amplifier. And once again, let me go by the common voltage divider kind of bias. So our well-known familiar diagram for BJT common emitter amplifier. So this is, let me just call R1. This is RC. This one is R2. This one is RE. This is the biasing part. And we do have the signal source, which is applied at the base, between the base and the ground. And the source is also having some internal resistance. And we do have this capacitor here. So let me call this as RS. And this is coupling capacitor, that is CC. And the input signal is applied over here, which we call like VI. So we'll be taking up the output from this terminal, VO. This is the DC ground. And you have a supply over here, that is VCC. That is our well-known circuit. Now, the question is that you have to find out the lower corner frequency. You have to understand what is meant by lower corner frequency. Now, before starting anything, let me just give you the numerical values. For R1, it is like 10 kilo ohms. R2 is given like 1.5 kilo ohms. RC is equal to 1 kilo ohms, and RE is given by 0.1 kilo ohms, and RS, the source resistance, is given by 0.5 kilo ohms, and the transistor parameter says that beta is equal to 100, the current gain, VB on is given by 0.7 volt, and the early voltage is assumed to be infinite. So that helps the calculation to a certain extent, because you need not calculate the value of R0, since VA equal to infinite, so R0 will be equal to 0. I mean, VO equal to infinite means R0 will also be infinite. So since it is connected in shunt in parallel with GMP pi, so the effect of R0 can be neglected, right? So now, first of all, you have to find out the DC parameters corresponding to this circuit. And now our familiar approach says that you need to find out this RThevenin, which is equal to R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. And the values are like 10 and 1.5. So let me just put the values over here, 10 into 1.5 divided by 10 plus 1.5. So the calculation says that it will be 15 divided by 11.5. And the value is coming like 1.3 kilo-ohms. 1.3 kilo-ohm, that is the value of RThevenin, and VThevenin is given by VCC into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So this calculation you have to continue. So R2 is given by 1.5. So 1.5 divided by 10 plus 1.5 multiplied with 5. I think VCC value has not been given over here. So let me just check. Okay, this problem says that this is equal to 12 volts. So it will be 12 volt, and I need to mention the value of VCC, obviously. Typically, the value of VCC is either taken as 5 volt or 6 volt or 12 volt or 10 volt, typically this. So VCC equal to 12 volt. So then it is coming like 12 into 1.5, that is 18, divided by 11.5. And the calculation reveals it is 1.565. So you can round it up to 1.57 volt. So VThevenin equal to 1.57 volt and RThevenin is equal to 1.3 kilo-ohms. Now with this, you can calculate the value of the base current IB. And the base current is given by, so I can directly write down the expression for the base current because you know how to calculate this one. So VThevenin minus VB on divided by RThevenin plus 1 plus beta times RE. So VThevenin is equal to 1.57, VB on given by 0.7 volt. RThevenin we have calculated like 1.3. So this one is 1.3. And beta is given by 100, so 101. And R is given by 0.1. So 101 into 0.1 will give you 10.1. So ultimately, you have 1.57 minus 0.7 will give you 0.87 divided by 11.4. So 1.57 minus 0.7, so 0.076. And since this RThevenin and RE, they are in the range of kilo-ohms, so obviously this value will be in milliampere. So the result is 0.076 milliampere. Or you can also call the base current to be 76 microampere. So 0.076 milliampere is the base current. So once you know the base current, then you can very easily calculate the value of RPi. So RPi is given by VT upon IB, and VT is given by 26 millivolt, and this is 0.076 milliampere. So 26 divided by 0.076 will give you 342. That means it is coming like 0.342 kilo-ohms. Now, once you know RPi, then you can also calculate the value of GM. But in this case, you don't require to calculate GM, hopefully, because what you need to do is that you have to calculate the lower corner frequency. Now, the calculation of the lower corner frequency, how does this calculation get affected by the value of this coupling capacitor, that we need to observe. So to understand this notion of this coupling capacitor, what you need to do is that we have to draw the small signal equivalent circuit of this BJT amplifier. So I think once again, let me just show you. This was our diagram. We have this R1, R2. So these two resistances are there. And in the small signal equivalent circuit, obviously you understand that these two, R1 and R2, they will be coming in parallel, because this is obviously AC ground, VCC, and this is DC ground. So DC ground means AC ground. So R1 and R2, they will be coming in parallel. So this is nothing but RThevenin. So RThevenin will be coming in parallel. I mean, RThevenin will be coming between the base and the ground. And this RE is there between the emitter and the ground terminal. And we have this RC, this collector resistance, which is there between the collector and the ground terminal in the small signal equivalent circuit. So first of all, let me draw this part of the circuit. So we have between base to ground. So if I call this my, this is my base terminal, and this is the ground terminal. So between base to ground, we have RThevenin, which is nothing but R1 parallel R2. And as you know, between the base and emitter of any transistor, we do have some RPi. So this is the emitter terminal. And remember, emitter is not grounded here. We don't have any bypass capacitor. We don't have any bypass capacitor over here. So only the effect of coupling capacitor is observed over here. So that's why this bypass capacitor is intentionally absent in this particular circuit. Now, since the bypass capacitor is absent, so emitter terminal is not at AC ground. Rather, it is grounded through a resistance RE. So if this is my emitter terminal, so let me call this is my emitter terminal. So between base to emitter, we do have RPi. And between collector to emitter, obviously, we do have GM times VPi. This current source, GM VPi, where VPi is the voltage across these two terminals. And this is the emitter terminal. And there is a resistance through which this point is grounded. This is RE. This is my collector terminal. This one is the emitter terminal. Now, collector to ground, already I have mentioned that there is a collector resistance, collector to ground. That is RC. And this is my output terminal, V0. Up to this, it is fine. Then we need to connect the other two parameters as well, other two components. One is this RS, second one is this CC, that is coupling capacitor. So how to connect them? So we do have the signal source here. We have signal source here, VI. And the source resistance RS. And now we are introducing for the first time the capacitor in the small signal equivalent circuit. So this one is RS. And this one is CC. So now we are not going into any mathematical calculation, any detailed calculation right now. Let us try to analyze what will be the performance of this kind of circuit. What I want to mean is that already you have calculated, you know how to find out the voltage gain. So voltage gain means what? We are interested in finding out the ratio between these two quantities, V0, which is the output voltage, and VI, which is the input voltage. The ratio between these two, V0 upon VI, that will give us the value of the voltage gain. And while analyzing this circuit, so far we have neglected the effect of this coupling capacitor. So what we have done so far is we have made these two points short-circuited. That means the effect of the coupling capacitor was removed. And by virtue of the analysis, we know that for this particular case, the voltage gain is given by minus RC upon RE, because we do have some resistance over there, emitter resistance over there. So that's why the voltage gain is given by minus RC upon RE. And if this resistance was bypassed by means of some bypass capacitor, in which case this emitter terminal was directly connected to AC ground, then you know what will be the effect, what will be the effect on the output voltage. The output voltage will be increased, and the value of this output voltage is given by, I mean, the gain of, I mean, if I just consider the gain of this particular amplifier, this gain will be given by minus GM times RC. So if I just consider the magnitude, it is only GM times RC. If this emitter is ground, I mean, if this emitter terminal is connected to AC ground, that means if I have some bypass capacitor connected in parallel with the resistance RE. But in this particular case, since we don't have any bypass capacitor, so the effect of RE has to be considered. And accordingly, the value of the voltage gain is given by minus RC upon RE. Now, if I just forget about the magnitude part for the time being, and if I just consider the corresponding, here you find that this value is equal to minus RC upon RE. So let me just write it down, the gain, the voltage gain AV, the mod value of this is given by RC upon RE. And that was calculated with CC short circuited. With CC short circuited, we have calculated this was my voltage gain. The value of AV is given by RC upon RE. Now, what happens if the effect of capacitor is there, if the effect of the coupling capacitor is not neglected? So you can assume that the signal frequency is not that large, so that we can just simply neglect the effect of this particular capacitor. Because you know, for any capacitor, the reactance for any capacitor is given by 1 upon J omega C. That is equal to 1 upon J twice pi FC. So what does it mean? If the value of F increases, then the value of this reactance will drop down. Now look here. Now in this particular case, this capacitor is there in series path. So you can only make it short circuited if the value of this XC is very, very small, if the value of this reactance is very, very small. Now this will only happen if the frequency operation is very large. Now if the frequency operation is very large, then irrespective of the value of this capacitor, in this particular case, the value of the capacitor is given by minus 0.1 microfarad. Now, irrespective of the value of this capacitor, if the value of F is very large, then this particular, I mean, if you just calculate this value of this reactance, that will be very small. And in which case you can consider, okay, these two points are basically connected together, this point and this point. So the effect of the capacitor can be neglected. So that assumption is correct if I move into the higher frequency range, if the value of F is very large. But now we are interested in looking at the lower frequency part as well. And in this particular problem, you have to find out the lower corner frequency. That means the frequency at which the signal, I mean, at which the gain. So if I just show you the overall frequency response, suppose this is my input signal. Suppose we do have a sinusoidal signal over here. And obviously, you know that there will be the output voltage, which is an amplified version. And at the same time, there is a phase reversal. Now, what happens is, if you just change the frequency operation of this particular sinusoidal signal, suppose the frequency is not fixed, you are just going to increase the frequency. Then what happens is, this gain, the value of the gain is not constant. The value of the gain is not constant. If you just increase the frequency, you'll find that, so this is F and this is mod AV. Now you'll find that if you increase the value of F, now what happens is, here the coupling capacitor is playing an important role, because as you understand here, previously if the capacitor was neglected, then the Vpi and Vi, so they are related by means of some factors, and these factors are basically constant. So that will depend upon the value of RAS, RThevenin, RPi, RE and all. So there is no voltage, I mean, there is no frequency dependent parameter between Vpi and Vi. But as soon as you introduce this coupling capacitor into this block, then obviously the amount of voltage that gets coupled over here across this RPi, that means Vpi, So it is this Vpi is no longer a constant term. Rather, it will depend upon the frequency of the operation. That means if the amount of frequency is very large, then obviously what happens? The capacitor is providing less amount of impedance to Vi. So more signal will be coupled over here. And if the value of the frequency is very small, then the capacitor CC will impose a significant impedance. And as a matter of fact, small amount of Vi will be coupled in the form of Vpi. So as a matter of fact, ultimately, this part of the circuit, because of the presence of CC, will be nothing but in this particular form. So basically, the input side, this will be something like that. So you have some capacitor that is CC, and apart from that, you have some R in, or I can consider this to be, say, let it be R in. Now you have to find out what is the relation between R in, R thevenin, RS, R pi, and R in. Now ultimately, this is the circuit, and this circuit is a familiar RC high pass circuit. So for high pass network, the nature, as you know, as the frequency increases, the corresponding gain value also increases. That is the nature of the high pass filter circuit. So the same thing is also applicable over here. And accordingly, you do have a response like this. And then ultimately, if the value of the frequency is very large, since the capacitor can be considered to be short circuited, then obviously the Vpi and Vi, so the ratio between these two parameters will be constant, and it will no longer be dependent on the frequency value. So then it will be constant. So the effect of capacitor, this coupling capacitor, will be something like this. And we are interested now, if this value, suppose if this is 100%, then we are interested in finding out this frequency, where at this particular frequency, which is known as the lower cutoff frequency, FL, where the corresponding gain is 70.7% of the maximum gain. And this is also known as the lower corner frequency or the 3 dB cutoff frequency, because in the log scale, if you just put this entire thing in the log scale, then you'll find that if this corresponds to, if this maximum gain value, if this one corresponds to 0 dB, then the gain at this particular frequency FL corresponds to minus 3 dB. So this particular value of FL is known as 3 dB cutoff frequency. And in order to find out this 3 dB cutoff frequency, what you need to do is that you need to find out what about the equivalent resistance R in. That R in, you need to compute what I have shown over here. You need to find out this R in with the help of R thevenin, R pi, and R in. Now to do this exercise, let me once again draw the same circuit, only the input side. So you need to find out this effective or the equivalent resistance. So this output side is not important to us right now. This one is RE, this one is R5. We have RS over here. This one is VI. And obviously you do have a GM times Vpi over here, but this part is not at all important right now. And obviously, rest part must follow. So first of all, looking at this terminal, suppose we would like to find out what will be the effective resistance. we are interested in finding out the effective resistance over here. So if I call this to be, say, the effective resistance, let it be, say, R dashed, looking at this terminal. So how to find out this effective resistance? So this is nothing but what about the effective voltage? What about the voltage between this terminal and ground? And what about the current being drawn? So you have to find out the ratio between these two, the what about the effective voltage between this terminal and the ground terminal, and what about the current being drawn. Now, you know, this current being drawn is nothing but the base current, that is IB. And if I call that this voltage potential at this particular point, let it be, say, V dashed with respect to ground. With respect to ground, let it be V dashed. Then what I can write is V dashed is nothing but IB times R pi plus, here you have the two components, the base component, base current, and the collector current as well. So IB plus beta IB times RD, because GM V pi is nothing but beta IB. So IB R pi plus IB into 1 plus beta, that means the emitter current, times RE. So V dash can be related to IB by means of this particular equation. So if you just calculate V dash upon IB, that is the effective resistance looking at this point. So this R dash, which is nothing but V dash upon IB, is coming out to be R pi plus 1 plus beta times. So you have already come across this kind of expression, R pi plus 1 plus beta times RD. Whenever you have some resistance over here, then this equivalent resistance looking at this terminal is nothing but R pi plus 1 plus beta times RD. So eventually, instead of this R pi and RD combination, what you do have is you do have a resistance connected in parallel with R thevenin, and this resistance is given by R dashed. So this resistance is essentially R dashed. So now you see these two resistances, that they are R dashed and R thevenin, they are in parallel. So what will be the effective resistance or equivalent resistance is nothing but, if I call at this terminal, if I call over here, the effective resistance, let it be R double dashed, then it is quite obvious that R double dashed is nothing but R dashed parallel R thevenin. Then your circuit reduces to this one. You have RS, a coupling capacitor here, and you have this one. This one is R double dashed, this one is RS, and this one is CC. So now your understanding in circuit theory simply tells that if you have a series combination like this, consisting of the capacitor CC and two resistances RS and R double dashed, then the equivalent resistance is given by R double dashed plus RS, and the equivalent capacitance is given by CC. And what about the effective time constant? The effective time constant tau is given by that RC time constant. So we have started with tau is equal to R in CC, that is equal to R double dashed plus RS into CC. So this is the effective time constant at the input side because of the presence of this coupling capacitor CC. And from that, you can find out the corresponding lower cutoff frequency FL, which is equal to 1 by twice pi tau, or 1 by twice pi R in times CC. So from that, you can calculate the value of FL. So let me just plug in the values. R dash is given by R pi plus 1 plus beta times RD. So we have already calculated R pi in some of the previous slides to be 0.342 kilo ohms. So then, our calculation says that R dashed, which is equal to R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So it will be in the range of kilo ohms, so 0.342 plus you have 101. I think last time I have just neglected this 101, hopefully. Yeah. I've just neglected this 101. Let me just check once again. 101, it should be 101. 1 plus beta will be 101 into 0.1. No, I have made it correctly, 10.1 anyway. So 101 into 0.1. That means 10.1. So 10.1 plus 0.342, that is 10.442. So our test is given by 10.44 kilo ohms. That was the value of our test, 10.44 kilo ohms. And our double test is nothing but RThevenin parallel our test. Now RThevenin I have already calculated during the bias calculation. It was like 1.3 kilo ohms. So RThevenin is 1.3 and it is 10.44. So 10.44 into 1.3 upon 10.44 plus 1.3. So 10.44 into 1.3 gives you 13.572 divided by, it will be 11.74. This gives us 1.156 kilo ohms. So our double test is given by 1.156 kilo ohms. So this R in, which is equal to our double test plus RS. So RS was given like 0.5 kilo ohms. So ultimately it will be 1.656 kilo ohms. And CC, we have already seen that at the very beginning of the discussion, it was mentioned that CC is equal to 0.1 microfarad. And obviously, there is a specific reason why the value of coupling capacity is selected to 0.1 microfarad. You can readily understand after we compute this final expression. So anyway, so the value of FL, that is the lower cutoff frequency, is given by 1 upon 2 pi into R in into CC. So it was kilo and micro. So ultimately it will be 10 to the power minus 3. So you can put 10 to the power 3 in the numerator and you have 2 pi into 1.656 into 0.1. Hertz. If you just calculate this one, 2 pi into 1.656, this will give you 1.039. Anyway, so we can make it like, so 10 to the power 3 divided by 1.034 hertz. It is coming like around 967 hertz. So this is the lower corner frequency of this particular amplifier being governed by the coupling capacitor. So ultimately, if I just take a look at the frequency response, and if I just take a look at the lower frequency part of this particular amplifier circuit, so this is F and this is mod AV. So what happens is, initially, if the value of the frequency is very small, then the coupling capacitor will impose significant amount of impedance. And as a matter of fact, less amount of voltage will be coupled across R pi. And obviously the voltage gain will be limited. Now, as the frequency increases, the reactance provided by the bypass coupling capacitor will be reduced and the amount of voltage getting coupled across RPi will be increased and the voltage gain will also be more. And ultimately, the voltage gain will be constant after a certain point of time. Now, if this value is considered to be 0 dB or maximum, then this point where this is just 3 dB less, this is known as the lower cutoff frequency FL. And here in this case, this is given by 967 Hz. That means what? From this point onwards, you can consider that the amplifier starts operating perfectly. Because beyond, if I just consider any value of the frequency which is less than FL, here the attenuation, I mean the corresponding value of the gain is very small, so you cannot consider it, right? So if the value of the frequency is higher than or equal to the lower cutoff frequency, then only you can appreciate the effect of amplification by this particular BJT amplifier. So the lower cutoff frequency for this particular problem under consideration is coming out to be 967 Hz. Similarly, and the higher side, you would have another roll off like this. So this is primarily because of the coupling capacitor, although we have not considered the effect of the bypass. By the maximum of them. For example, if I have, say, a multi-stage amplifier, for which you have one coupling capacitor in the first stage, another coupling capacitor in the second stage, another coupling capacitor in the first stage, and each of them are having some different value of body, each of them are providing different value, like FL1, FL2, and FL3. Then for the overall amplifier, if I just consider, then for the overall amplifier, the effective value of the lower cutoff frequency is nothing but the maximum of the different FLs. Similarly, for the higher cutoff frequency, it will be just the reverse, the minimum of the different higher cutoff frequency. So I was just imposing one question over here, that why the value of the coupling capacitor was selected to be 0.1 microfarad. Because in most of the books, if you just go through the different problems, you'll find that the coupling capacitor, even in the lab, you'll find that the coupling capacitors are selected in this particular range. For a common emitter amplifier, it is like 0.1 microfarad. Why the coupling capacitor is selected in the range of microfarad? That is very important. The thing is that the value of the coupling capacitor, if you select a value of the coupling capacitor even small, then what happens? This coupling capacitor is there in the denominator, in the overall expression of the lower cutoff frequency. Now, if you make any attempt to reduce the value of this coupling capacitor beyond this microfarad, then obviously what happens? The lower cutoff frequency is going to be increased. And that is not our purpose. Our purpose is to enhance the bandwidth of the amplifier. That means if I have two different cutoff frequencies, because ultimately for the overall amplifier, the frequency response will be something like this. This is for the coupling capacitor, and for the transistor internal capacitor, there'll be another cutoff frequency. So ultimately you do have two different cutoff frequency. This one is known as the FL, the lower cutoff frequency. And similarly, you do have another cutoff frequency, which is known as the higher cutoff frequency. Higher cutoff frequency. And ultimately, the bandwidth of the amplifier is given by the FH minus FL, the difference between these two. So obviously, what will be our purpose for the design of any amplifier? We would be interested in shifting this FL towards this end and shifting this FH towards this end. That means we will try to enhance this range by reducing FL and by increasing FH. So that is our purpose. So we cannot afford any value of a coupling capacitor less than that, less than this microfarad range. Otherwise, it will seriously impose certain problems in the design of the amplifier. So this particular problem gives you certain idea regarding the effect of coupling capacitor in controlling the lower cutoff frequency. And obviously, the lower cutoff frequency will also be having certain say on the bandwidth. Also, I can tell you right at this moment that the effect of, or the overall effect of the bandwidth cannot be justified just by observing the lower cutoff frequency. Because ultimately, whenever you will see the value of the higher cutoff frequency, you'll find that this will be in the range of few hundreds of kilohertz. And here you find that this is coming like in the range of few hundreds of hertz, is 967 hertz. Or roughly you can consider it to be, say, close to 1 kilohertz. Now that is the lower cutoff frequency, and the higher cutoff frequency, normally it is in the range of a few hundreds of kilohertz, or sometimes it is in the order of few megahertz. Now with respect to hundreds of kilohertz, this 1 kilohertz or something less than 1 kilohertz is not that important. But still, you can understand the impact of this coupling capacitor. It says that you cannot amplify any signal, or even if you amplify, you cannot get the desired gain if the value of the corresponding frequency is less than the lower cutoff frequency. Now, let me take up the second problem, in which case the effect of the coupling capacitor will not be considered. So here, what we have done is, we have assumed that the frequency of operation is small enough so that the effect of the coupling capacitor is very much dominant. So we cannot neglect the effect, and we cannot make it simple short-circuited. Now, in the second problem, what we do is we just reverse our approach, and we expect that here the effect of the coupling capacitor can be neglected because the frequency operation is very large. But even if you neglect the frequency, even if you neglect the effect of coupling capacitor, but you cannot neglect the transistor internal capacitor. Why so? You can understand if I just pick up this problem. So once again, a similar kind of circuit. Now here you have, along with an emitter resistance, we do have one emitter bypass capacitor. So that will help your calculation to a certain extent, because we can assume that the value of this bypass capacitor, or the you can assume that the frequency operation is such that is selected such that this bypass capacitor can be considered to be short circuited, so that this emitter terminal could be considered to be at AC ground. So all of them are tied together. And then you have this coupling capacitor, but the effect of this will not be visualized here, because we are assuming that we are interested in observing the effect of this particular amplifier for a very high value of the frequency. And we'd have some current source kind of signal source. We are modeling this like this one. Current source here, IS. Source resistance RS, coupling capacitor R1, R2, RC. You can consider this to be the second coupling capacitor. This is the emitter bypass capacitor, RE, and the load resistance RL, and this is the output voltage. And we do have VCC over here. Now, here you have two different problems. You need to find out the Miller capacitance, and you need to find out the 3 dB frequency. And this time, this 3 dB frequency is a higher cutoff frequency, 3 dB higher cutoff frequency. Now, the different parameters are like this. R1 is given by 200 kilo ohms. R2 is given by 220 kilo ohms. RC is given by 2.2 kilo ohms. RL is given by 4.7 kilo ohms. RE is given by 1 kilo ohms. RS is given by 100 kilo ohms. And VCC here is equal to 5 volt. And the beta value is considered to be 100. VBE on is equal to 0.7 volt. VA early voltage is also called infinite here. So you can safely neglect R naught. And additionally, two parameters. So here, interestingly, the CC1 and CC2, so and the C, so these values are not given in the problem itself because we are interested in finding out the Miller capacitance and the higher 3 dB cutoff frequency. So as we are increasing the frequency of operation, so obviously we expect that if the frequency of operation is very large, then this coupling capacitor, reactance provided by this coupling capacitor will be small enough so that you can consider that these two terminals are connected together, short circuited. Similarly, these two terminals are connected together. This emitter terminal is connected to ground. So that's why the values for CC1, CC2, and C are not given. Rather, the values for the transistor internal capacitor, C pi, which is the base emitter capacitor. So let me write it down like CBE, or this is also known as C pi. So this is given. This is given as 10 picofarad, and CBC. Or C mu, this is given as 2 picofarad. So you need to find out the Miller capacitance and you need to find out the 3 dB higher cutoff frequency. So obviously, the same type of approach you have to take over here. So I'm not going into the details of this calculation because as I understand that these two calculations are almost identical. I mean, as far as the DC analysis and the calculation of the parameters for the BJT is concerned. So intentionally what I've done is I have pre-calculated all these defined parameters like the base current, DC base current, obviously, the DC collector current. And from that, I have also pre-calculated the value of the internal parameters like R pi and GM. So let me just plug in the values over here. So the same approach you have to take over here as well. The R Thevenin is nothing but the R1 R2 parallel combination. V Thevenin is nothing but VCC into R2 R1 plus R2. And from that, you can calculate the value of IB, like V Thevenin minus VB on divided by this R Thevenin plus 1 plus beta times RE. So the same approach. This is also valid here for this particular case. And I'm just putting the values what I've got. So the pre-calculation says that the IBQ value is equal to 9 microampere because that will be the previous thing. So 9 microampere and ICQ is close to, it will be 90 milliampere. And the value of GM, so the value of GM, VT is equal to 26 millivolt, we have considered. So the value of GM is coming like 0.0346 ampere per volt. And R pi is coming like 2.89 kilo ohms. IBQ, the DC base current, was coming like 9 microampere. And the IC value is coming like 19 milliampere. GM is coming like 0.0346 ampere per volt, assuming the thermal voltage to be 26 millivolt at room temperature, and R pi is coming like 2.89 kilo ohms. Now, after this, it is fine. Now, let me first draw the small signal equivalent circuit, and then you can appreciate the effect of the transistor internal capacitors. So, between base to ground, we do have R Thevenin. Let me just plug in the So between base to ground, we have R Thevenin, and emitter is grounded here. You have to understand that emitter is grounded because the frequency operation is large enough so that this bypass capacitor could have been considered to be short circuited. So the emitter terminal is connected to AC ground. So RPi, which was eventually connected between base and emitter, so you can consider this is basically connected between base and AC ground like this. So this one is RPi. And obviously, since this coupling capacitor, the effect of the coupling capacitor is absent here. So this is short circuited and RS is connected between this point to ground. That means between base to ground. So RS is also connected between base to ground like this. So this one is RS. Now this side you have GM times Vpi, where Vpi is this voltage across RPi is known to be Vpi, and this one is the ground terminal, AC ground. And since VA, the early voltage is fortunately infinite, so you can get rid of R naught. Otherwise, you have to consider the help of R naught over here. So only you have RC connected between collector terminal to ground, because VCC is at AC ground. And also, let me just go back over here. So RC is connected between collector to ground because VCC is nothing but AC ground. And since the frequency operation is large, so this coupling capacitor, the second coupling capacitor, that is also considered to be short circuited. So then this RL, that is also connected between collector to AC ground directly. So RC and RL, they will be coming in parallel. So this one is RL, and this is the output voltage VO. And obviously we do have the current source as the signal source at this particular point. Yes. So I have just forgot to mention the value of RThevenin and only RThevenin, I guess. Yes. So 4.76 kilo ohms. Why should I put here? Let me put over here because RThevenin calculation come first. So RThevenin is 104.76 kilo ohms. So after this, you find that there is no, up to this, in this particular circuit, you will find that there is no such capacitor, right? So eventually, the voltage gain will be independent of the signal frequency. But however, since we are considering a frequency which is large enough, so then the effect of the transistor internal capacitor you need to consider. So there are two different capacitors. One is, so let me just mark the corresponding terminals. So this is the base terminal, as you know. This is the collector terminal, and this is the emitter terminal. You know it very well. So now, it's an NPN transistor, so emitter base collector. So between emitter to base, you have one capacitor internally connected between emitter to base, and between base to collector, you have another capacitor. So these two capacitors we need to connect in the circuit right now. So one capacitor is there between base to collector, and another capacitor is there between base to emitter. So this is one capacitor, which we call CBE, or this is popularly known as CPi, because it is coming in parallel with RPi. And the second capacitor, which is coming in this path between base to collector, this is known as CMU. Now, an interesting observation you can see over here, that CPi is connected between these two terminals, base to emitter or base to ground, and there is no feedback associated with it, because emitter terminal is considered to be common for a common emitter configuration for both the input and the output, and the base is considered to be the input terminal for a common emitter amplifier. However, this particular capacitor, C mu, this is connected between the two nodes. Now, one node is the input node, and second node is the output node. input node is the base node for common emitter common emitter amplifier, and collector node is the output node for common emitter amplifier. Now, there's an important and interesting observation you can make over here, that the C mu, this base collector capacitor for common emitter amplifier only, obviously, this is connected. I mean, one end of this capacitor is connected at the base end, input end. The other end is connected at the collector end, not the output end. So, to identify the effect of this C mu at the input side and as well as in the output side, we need to apply the Miller's theorem. And if you just go through a lecture video pertaining to unit 4, then you can see that the effect of C mu can be divided at the input side as well as output side by means of Miller's theorem. And ultimately, at the input side, this C mu can be visualized like C mu multiplied with 1 minus A, where A is the voltage gain of this particular amplifier between this point and this point. So here, instead of having C mu over here, so let me once again draw the same circuit. So you have a RS over here, R Thevenin, R pi. So this one is R Thevenin, this one is R pi. C pi is fine. You can consider C pi between the base to ground, base to emitter, C pi. And the effect of this C mu over here between this end and the ground end is given by, this is also known as the Miller capacitance, and you need to find those Miller capacitance here. And this Miller capacitance is given by Cm. And the value of Cm is given by C mu into 1 minus A, where A is the gain, the voltage gain between this point and this point. That is the effect of C mu in the input side. And then in the output side, you have Gm times V pi. And you do have RC, RL, so they are coming in parallel. RC and RL, so they are coming in parallel. And once again, you need to consider the effect of this C mu in the output side. And for the very large value of A, you will find that if the normally we are considering a common emitter amplifier, and we expect that the value of A is typically very large, at least higher than 100. So for a very large value of this A, this C mu could have been in the effect of C mu at the output side can be observed as C mu only. In fact, the expression was like A by A minus 1 into C mu. So very large value of A, that can be considered to be C mu itself. So this is nothing but C mu. And this is the output voltage over here. So by virtue of this modification, now we can get rid of this kind of connection, which acts like a bridge between the input and output, and we can visualize the effect of these two RC networks separately. So let me just tell you after completing the circuit. Yes. So now you do have two defined RC networks. So this network is known as the input RC network, and this network is known as the output RC network. So in the input RC network, you have these resistances RS, R Thevenin, and R pi. So these resistances are coming in shunt. So the effective resistance or the overall resistance, equivalent resistance, will be given by RS parallel R Thevenin parallel R pi. Similarly, you have a C pi and Cm. They are coming in shunt in parallel. And if you just consider the equivalent capacitors connected in parallel, and the equivalent capacitor will be given by C pi plus Cm. So the effective capacitor over here at the input side is given by Cpi plus Cm, and the effective or the equivalent resistance is given by the parallel combination of Rs, RThevenin and Rpi. Similarly, here in the output side, you have Rc and RL. These two resistances, they are coming in parallel. So obviously, the effective resistance will be Rc parallel RL, and you have a C mu, this capacitor. Now, the next question is that you have calculated the effective resistance, effective capacitance, both at the input side of the network and as well as at the output side of the network. The next question is that what type of circuit it is, whether it's a high-pass network or low-pass network, that you must understand. Here you see that for both the input networks as well as in the output networks, the capacitors are there in the shunt path, in the parallel path. So what happens if the frequency of operation increases? For example, if I just consider this one, if the frequency of operation increases, the corresponding reactance provided by the capacitors will be reduced. And ultimately, these capacitors will try to make this particular point, to connect this particular point to AC ground. We'll try to pull down this point to AC ground. So as the frequency of operation increases, so the output voltage over here is approaching towards zero. So that means eventually here the circuit is something like that. So previously I've seen that you have a capacitor, then you have a resistance. Now here the circuit is something like that. You have a resistance over here, fine, and you have a capacitor over here. So if you have a circuit like this, from your understanding in circuit theory, you must be knowing. Now if the and this is the output terminal. Now, if the capacitor is placed in parallel with the output nodes, then obviously this network resembles that of a low-pass network. So as the frequency of operation increases here, you'll find that the gain provided by this particular network goes on decreasing, which is just the opposite what we have seen in the last example or last problem. So now you need to, first of all, you need to calculate the Miller capacitance. That was the first problem. You need to calculate the Miller capacitance Cm, which is given by C mu into 1 minus A. And remember here, whenever I write A here, so it doesn't include. So it includes both the magnitude as well as the corresponding phase. So if the value of A is like minus 50, so you have to put like minus 50. So it will be ultimately 1 minus or minus 50. If I consider a circuit like this, where this emitter resistance is bypassed by means of the bypass capacitor CE, so obviously the overall voltage gain in the mid band. So obviously, although I have written like A, so I must be careful that it should be A naught. That means the mid band gain, because A is not fixed here. So A naught is the mid band gain. So what about the midband gain here for this particular circuit? So the midband gain here is nothing but minus GM times RC parallel RL. So midband gain, what I have shown before connecting these two capacitors, if I just consider this green network, then the midband gain is given by minus GM times RC parallel RL. So RC is given by 2.2 kilo ohms and RL was 4.7 kilo ohms. So RC parallel RL, if you do this calculation, RC parallel RL, yes, it is 2.2 into 4.7. It is coming like 1.498 kilo ohms. That is the value of RC parallel RL. And GM already we have calculated. So that calculation says that it is 0.0346 ampere per volt. So the gain A naught is given by minus GM times RC parallel RL. Minus sign is there because it's a common emitter amplifier, so there is a phase reversal. So then it will give 0.0346 into 1.498 this much of kilo. It's coming like 51 point minus 51.8. That is the mid band gain. Then what about the Miller capacitance? So Miller capacitance is given by C mu into 1 minus A. So C mu was given by 2 picofarad, I guess. So 51.8. So 52.8 into 2. It's coming like 105.6 picofarad. So this is coming like 105.6 picofarad CM. And the total capacitor C total at the input side is given by CM plus C pi. C pi was given like 10 picofarad, so ultimately it will be 115.6 picofarad. And you need to calculate what about the effective resistance over here, RS, RThevenin, RPi. So RS was like 100 kilo ohms, I guess. It was 100 kilo ohms RS. RThevenin was, we have calculated it to be 104.76 kilo ohms. And we have RPi. It's 2.89 kilo ohms. Then obviously, if you just find out their equivalent resistance when all of them are connected in shunt, then the effective resistance R in will be RS parallel RThevenin parallel RPi, and that value obviously it will be less than the minimum out of these three. And if you calculate this one, you'll find that I'm not going into the calculation because it's pretty simple, 2.73 kilo ohms. R in is equal to 2.73, C total is equal to 115.6 picofarad. So from that you can have F higher cutoff frequency coming because of the input network is given by 1 by 2 pi R in into C total in basically. So 6.28 into R in is 2.73. It is kilo ohms and this one is picofarad. So ultimately you have like 10 to the power 3, 10 to the power minus 12. So in the numerator you have 10 to the power 9. Into C total is 115.6. This will give me 1981.89. Anyway, 1981.89. So ultimately it is like, I can put it like 1000 by 1981.89, this much of megahertz. 2 pi R in C total will give me 1981.89, and this 10 to the power minus 12 can be broken into 10 to the power 3 into 10 to the, I mean 10 to the minus 12 into 10 to the power plus 3. So 10 to the power minus 9 in the denominator, whenever it comes over here in the numerator, so 10 to the power 9, so it can be broken up into 10 to the power 3 into 10 to the power 6. This much of megahertz. So 1000 divided by 1981.89 will give me like the value to be 0.505 megahertz. So you understand it's almost more than 500 kilohertz. It's 505 kilohertz. So in the range of few hundreds of kilohertz as compared to the lower cutoff frequency. What you have seen, the lower cutoff frequency was like in the previous example, obviously it was in the range of few hundreds of hertz. Now with respect to that, this higher cutoff frequency is coming out to be few hundreds of kilohertz. It's like 0.5 megahertz. So that higher cutoff frequency you have calculated just by observing the input side of the network. But remember, here basically you do have the two low pass filters. You do have two different low pass filters. One in the input side. You have one low pass filter here, and this is connected with another low pass filter, which is also present in the output side. Now here you'll be getting some FH in, and here you'll be getting another FH out. Now suppose, obviously you understand what should be the nature. The nature will be low pass nature, so it will be something like this. Suppose these are the two different cutoff frequency. One is this one, that is FH in, and suppose this one, FH out. Now these two are connected in cascade. I mean, input and output, they are connected in cascade, one after another. So what will be the overall cutoff frequency? What do you mean by this cutoff frequency? That means this particular amplifier, I mean this part, this input network, will not allow any frequency beyond FH in, because the corresponding gain is pretty small. So this is not at all acceptable. So any frequency higher than FH in will not be considered, will be rejected simply by the input network. And similarly for the output network, any frequency higher than FH out will also be rejected simply. So what will be the effective or the overall higher cutoff frequency? So this effective or the overall higher cutoff frequency is the minimum out of these two. Last time in the previous example, you have seen that if we have some lower cutoff frequency like FL1, FL2, and FL3, so the effective value was considered to be the max. So it was like although this is not in connection with this problem anyway. So the FL effective, it was the maximum because we have a high pass filter kind of thing. So maximum of FL1, FL2, FL3, and so on. And here, since we have a low pass filter in this particular case, so it will be minimum of FH1, FH2, FH3, and so on. So there could have been more such components because of which the cutoff frequencies are coming into picture. So we have calculated this one for FH in already, and that is coming like 0.505 megahertz. Now let me calculate the same thing for FH out. So for FH out, you do have two different things, is RC and RL, and you have C mu. So RC RL parallel combination, we have already seen this value to be 1.498 kilo-ohms, and C mu, it was given like 2 picofarad. So we can calculate this FH out to be 1 upon 2 pi RC parallel RL into C mu. Now if you plug in the values, then it will be like 2 pi into 1.498 kilo into 2 pico, that means into 10 to the power 9. So 6.28 into 2 to 1.498. It is coming like 18.8149. So 1000 upon 18.8149 megahertz. So 1000 divided by 80.849 will give you something around 53 point something. So around 53 megahertz. So here you find that the output higher cutoff frequency resulting from the output network is large, 53 megahertz, whereas the input cutoff frequency is in the range of few hundreds of kilohertz, like at least less than 1 megahertz for this particular problem, at least less than 1 megahertz. However, this one is around 50 megahertz. So for any practical problem, you will find that this higher cutoff frequency is essentially governed by the input side. Normally, because of the Miller magnification, because here you have seen that the cutoff frequencies are basically the value of this cutoff frequency. So they are inversely proportional to the RC time constant. And if you just compare the value of this effective resistance, so here it is like 2.73 kilo ohms for the input side Rin, and here it is like 1.49. So they are pretty much comparable to some extent, 2.73 and 1.49 in the range of kilo ohms. So they are pretty much comparable. But what makes the difference is the C total value. So the input side, you have like 115 picofarad because of the Miller magnification. So it is like 115 picofarad. On the other hand, the output side, you have only 2 picofarad. So around 50 times less. And that gets reflected in the output cutoff frequency. Now, to some extent, so here you find that this output cutoff frequency or the output network doesn't have any say in controlling the higher cutoff frequency. Basically, the higher cutoff frequency is governed by the input network. But in some exceptional cases, if you have some load resistance, load capacitors connected in parallel with this load resistance RL, that means instead of having this RL, if you do have another capacitor, load capacitor connected in shunt in parallel with this RL, then what happens is, because of the presence of this capacitor between this output node and the ground, in the small signal equivalent circuit, this load capacitor will be there in parallel with this C mu. Now, if the load capacitor is there in parallel with C mu, then obviously the effective capacitor and the output side is equal to the summation of C mu plus CL. Now, CL is the external capacitor which you can control, which you can connect in the circuit. Now, just by increasing the value of CL at per your requirement, what you can do is you can modify or you can increase the RC time constant of the output network. And accordingly, this under this particular case, this output network may be having some say in controlling the higher cutoff frequency. But normally, in most of the cases, and if you don't have any explicit load capacitor, and if you have to rely only on the effect of this Miller, if you have to rely on this Miller effect, and if you don't have any explicit load capacitor over here, under this case, the higher cutoff frequency is basically governed by the input network. But even in this particular case, you have to, if it is asked that you have to calculate the higher cutoff frequency, the higher cutoff 3 dB frequency, then it is advisable that you must calculate the cutoff frequency resulting from the input network and the cutoff frequency resulting from the output network and compare them, which one is the minimum. And you select the minimum of these two to find out the effective higher cutoff frequency. So here the effective higher cutoff frequency is given by the input higher cutoff frequency, and that is given by 0.505 megahertz. However, for the lower cutoff frequency, you have to consider the different kind of thing, where you have to consider the max of a different cutoff frequency, like FL1, FL2, and FL3. With this, I have just considered two different typical problems. One in connection with the effect of the coupling capacitor. You can understand what is the effect of coupling capacitor on the frequency response characteristics of any BJT amplifier, common emitter amplifier, obviously. And the second one, in the second problem, we have considered the effect of the transistor internal capacitors, this base emitter internal capacitor C pi and the base collect internal capacitor C mu. to identify their effect on the frequency characteristics of the BJT amplifier. Now with this, I would like to conclude my today's discussion.